Alcohol ink and water-based acrylic paints don't mix, right? The prevailing wisdom is that a product that's solvent-based like the inks won't mix or blend with a water-based paint, and that's true, they won't blend together. Instead, what happens is that alcohol inks, when dropped on a wet water-based paint, cause it to move in what can only be described as wildly unpredictable ways. Today I'm going to show you some of my process that causes this kind of magic to happen, and I'll also demo a bit of doodling on my pieces. This technique produces really wonderful results, wildly unpredictable as I said in the introduction, but you can do some really interesting things with them. And here are some examples of ones that I've already worked on. Now, I have something else that I want to show you. I've discovered that this particular technique where you're dropping alcohol ink on a wet acrylic paint, you need to work on either a non-porous surface, and this is Yupo, so this is plastic for all intents and purposes that's been stretched to make a sheet of plastic paper, or you need to work on something like a gessoed canvas. You can gesso a piece of paper. This is an example of me gessoing. This is one of the Strathmore Bristol, watercolor art tiles. This is 6x6, and you see this white frame. That's because I taped it to the table so it wouldn't buckle, and then I put a nice heavy coat of gesso on, let it dry completely, and then I put my paint on, and you'll see that process. But the reason that gessoing or a non-porous surface is important is because if you don't, the alcohol inks are just going to push through the paint and they're going to soak into the paper and you're not going to get this bloom. So remember, gesso or a non-porous surface. So if you watched any of the original alcohol ink on Yupo videos, you'll remember that the alcohol ink will bloom in a reasonably predictable pattern. So this is just a piece of plain Yupo. Now, I've avoided getting my fingers on this. The oil from your fingers will affect the bloom. So sometimes you'll see that the inks don't bloom in quite the way that you expected. But this is a reasonably predictable bloom. Even if I bring in the Copic reinkers, you're going to get a very similar thing because we're talking, whoops, that's crusty dried up stuff. But you're talking basically the same process. You're going to get a reasonably predictable bloom. When you put a coat of wet paint on and then you start to drop your alcohol ink on top of that is when things get very unpredictable indeed. So I'm going to grab, if I can figure out what I did with my pad of Yupo, I'm working with Yupo 5x7. This is the white. Now in this case, if you get your fingers on here and you get a little bit of oil from your hands on here, it really doesn't make any difference because you're going to put a layer of paint on there to begin with. So let's talk about paint. This was done with Lumiere's Halo Pink Gold. That's this. What's really interesting about this is that the paint itself is pink, but the mica in it is gold. And you can see the incredible reflection of that gold as it gets pushed. And it starts to condense in areas because the alcohol ink is pushing the stuff away. This was done with pearl white. Again, that's this particular paint here, done in on a standard piece of Yupo. This is the blue, which is the background, is Pebbio's iridescent acrylic. And while the sheen on this is a little bit different, it provides really interesting results too. I'm a big fan of this paint. This piece here was also done. This is with the yellow-green. What you can see on here are a fair number of brush strokes. Now, if that bothers you, there are obviously ways to get paint on there without having the brush strokes be quite so obvious. But you can see that all of these are going to work equally well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to work with this particular Pebbio paint, and I have a bucket of water here off to the side and a paintbrush. This doesn't take a lot of paint. You're going to find that you'll want to mix it about half and half. It needs to be reasonably liquidy. You need to get enough of the pigment on there so that you can actually see what's going on. You need that color on there. And then it does need to be damp. If the paint is not wet when you apply the alcohol ink to it, you're going to get a very muted response. And by muted, I mean you're not going to get all of that blooming, that craziness that happens. So I've got my paint and I'm, watered down here. Ideally, you're looking at probably a 1-to-1 ratio, and this kind of liquidy look here, that's more or less what you're looking for. So I'm just going to very casually apply the paint. I really don't care how it goes on because the ink is going to make such a difference in terms of what it looks like after the fact that how it goes on kind of doesn't matter. Now, as I said, it's important that you keep, let me just wipe up the mess here, that you keep this damp. So before you start to apply the ink, you're going to take a look and think, all right, is this damp enough? And if it's not, grab your handy dandy sprayer. All right, now with that done, I'm going to actually zoom in a little bit for you so you can really see this process. With that done, I'm just going to give this a little spritz of water. Now, interestingly enough, the droplets kind of keep that pattern going in there, and it will stay to some extent, but the ink is going to move this stuff so much that it's almost negligible how much it's going to affect things. So I'm going to pick some colors of Copic Refills and some Ranger Alcohol Ink. I'm going to grab this yellow, and someplace in here is a lighter. All right, so let's start with Ranger's Alcohol Ink, and here's where the magic is. Again, wildly unpredictable. This time I'm getting kind of a roughly edged floral shape. Next time, maybe not so much. You just kind of have to take it as it comes. You have to be willing to accept the fact that this is incredibly unpredictable. But one of the interesting things, you see this bleeding. I don't know how else to describe it, as part of the alcohol ink actually separates from the body of that drop and it pushes out into the paint. Now, if this is all you wanted to do, let's say you wanted to just make these dots flowers and you wanted to leave the background kind of alone, you can do that. So let's pretend for 1 second that that's what we're going to do. I'll show you something else in a minute. So now what you can do, this is isopropyl, 91% isopropyl alcohol that I've got marks on here. Of course, some of it's rubbed off, but I can identify this as being alcohol instead of being water, and you'll need to take care to do that. So I'm going to take the sprayer out, or the spray pickup tube and the nozzle out, and I can go ahead and I can do this. Excuse me for sniffling, I have a head cold. Or I can mist and I can do that. If I wanted instead, let me come back and grab another piece of Yupo, and I'm going to do the same thing again, but this time I'm going to play. And if I had left that alone, the bloom would have been far more discreet and we would have had something that looked more like flowers, but sometimes it's fun for me to experiment and show you what happens if. So let me grab a little bit more paint, and I'm going to just put this over to the side so I don't have to clean it up. It won't be in my way. And I'm going to thin this down and come back and get another coat of the Hebeo Iridescent Acrylic on the Yupo so we can go back to playing with multiple colors. And I know you can't see, but trust me, I'm just doing the same thing again. I'm mixing, and now I'm going to get this paint on here. Again, it doesn't really matter how it goes on. It just matters that it's on there. And if I think I need to add a little bit of water, I'll do that. So I might give this a spritz of water, because what happens is, if you don't have enough liquid on there and it's not wet enough, whoops, I missed this corner, if it's not wet enough, then you're not going to get that crazy bloom. All right, so let's come back. This time I'm going to start with this. This happens to be a Copic Refill. And I'm just going to start dropping things on here. And again, you get this incredibly, wildly unpredictable stuff that happens that if there's a rhyme or reason to, I have not been able to identify it yet. Whoops. Now I'm going to come in and put in some of the yellow. This, I think, is lemonade. I can drop it in some of what's already there, or I can just come out. And one of the things that I've discovered is that if you just tap like this, you can get littler drops than you will if you just put big drops on there. So this is the process. I want to come back and I want to show you the Lumiere Pearl White, because I think it provides a rather interesting look, and it allows you to create, as I said, where'd my canvas go? This was done with the pearl white on the background, so you almost don't get the sense that you've added color to the background, and if you want to do something like this little landscape, you can. And again, these are just dots that are done that way. You can see I've kind of got my pencil lines on there. And then we're going to talk about what happens when you start getting out pens and you bring out the Pebeo acrylic paint markers, and you can start to do all kinds of crazy doodlings and dots and all fun things. Another reason that I prefer to work on Yupo is that not only doesn't it need to be gessoed because it's a non-porous surface, it doesn't buckle when you put water on it, which means I don't have to tape it down, and to me, that's a win-win situation. So this is the one that we did just a moment ago, and if I hold this up, you can certainly see the luminance, that metallic iridescent sheen from the Pebbio paint. You can also notice here, and this is something that I didn't get, so here are a couple that I did originally, and you saw these previously. This one has a lot less alcohol ink splotches on it, and one of the things that becomes immediately noticeable, at least to me, is that there's this white halo that happens, and that white halo pretty much remains when the paint doesn't all get pushed up against it because you add more drops. So you add a drop, it pushes the paint out, you get this white halo. And if you don't add a bunch more drops around it, that white halo really can stay in place, which means now this is fodder for all kinds of doodling. I can do various things with that, I can take advantage of that. Which isn't to say that you can't doodle on this, because you certainly can, but you're going to get a different look because you've maintained that halo. So this time, as I said a moment ago, I'm going to bring in the pearl white, because you don't always want a background color, and if you don't want a background color, then one of the ways to get something working like this is to use a white paint. Now I'm going to use, you can't see me, I'm just doing this off to the side, I'm putting the paint out so I can thin it. I'm going to choose a metallic 9 times out of 10 because it's my preference, and so that's why I'm using the Lumiere. If I wanted to, I could just put plain old white paint on here and I could get the same effect and you wouldn't see any of it, but why would I go plain when I can go with metallic and get all that fun stuff that happens because it's metallic. So there's my coat of white paint on there. I'm just going to wipe this up so I can bring the bottles around and I'm not sort of making a mess. And then I'm just going to quickly spritz this so I make certain that there's enough liquid on here. And this is that fine line thing. You need enough liquid so that the paint can react, but not so much that it just reacts wildly and there's way too much liquid on there. And I've made that mistake, so trust me, you don't want to go there. So I'm bringing in a few colors of Ranger's Alcohol Ink. This is Flamingo. Valencia is the orange color. So again, I'm just going to do some dots. I mean, anybody can do this. You can do this with kids because the dots are so easy. And how cool is this bleeding action that happens? And let's bring this other one back in. I don't remember if that happened here in the last segment when we did this, but you're definitely getting this effect, and probably because we're working on white paint and you can see it a little bit more. So I'm going to be careful. I'm not going to use too much color. I want to leave this so that I've given myself what looks like flowers, and I don't want to obliterate them. So maybe I'm going to choose, this is aqua. This is kind of a light color. Actually, you know what? I think I'm going to go with yellow. Take that back. So I'm going to bring in the lemonade, and I'm just going to put a little bit in the center here. Well, that wasn't enough, was it? All right, so that's not working at all. We're going to try it anyway and see what happens. All right, so now I think I need to go with some more water. When all else fails, try some more water, and that's what's going to help you get a reaction. So just for consistency, I'm going to put a drop there. I'm going to spritz some more water on. You can see I'm getting more movement. And now I'm going to come in and just put the occasional drop of yellow in. And though it's, I can see it, there's that same kind of haloing effect is going on here as well. So the addition of water really changed my original drops because I put water on top of the alcohol ink. Whereas here, I've got that little bit more predictable pattern, as much as this is predictable, and obviously it's really not. But if I were to come back and put more water on here, which I'm not going to do because I don't want to change this, I really like the way it looks, then I would, this kind of effect, I think, would be happening on just those plain yellow dots. So, you know, the sky's the limit here. I'm going to come back, I want to show you some of the doodling I do, but when you think about the variety of iridescent paints out there with the Pebbio Studio Acrylics, and certainly the Lumiere, and there's Halo Violet Gold, there's Halo Blue Gold to go along with the Halo Pink Gold, and now you can get that gold effect going on kind of like what I showed you here, because I used the pink gold here. It becomes this sort of endless and open possibility stream. What can you do? How can you make this work? And the combinations are just incredible. This is the piece I worked on in the last segment. I have to say, I really do like it a lot. Adding water on top of the alcohol ink really results in some interesting spreading, once it's there and it's already started to do its thing. I like that option to do that. I haven't exactly decided what I'm going to do with this yet. I know I want to transform these into flowers somehow. I just haven't quite figured out what. So I'm going to put that to the side for a second and bring in some of these other ones that you can see I've started to do some doodling on. When you have larger elements like this that are not so crammed in as they are here and here, it might be a little bit easier to pick out your flowers, or you can simply come in and find what's there and work with it. And that's more or less what I've done here. Now, you don't have to make things into flowers if you don't want to. Sometimes it's as simple as just putting lines on here, or excuse me, putting dots on the lines that are kind of built in from the way the alcohol inks dry when they sort of move and pull together. For this kind of work, I really like Pitt pens. First of all, another reason to love the Yupo is how flat, and I don't just mean how the surface doesn't buckle, but the paper itself has a very flat finish on it, and that really does kind of transfer through the ink and the paint on here, giving you a really smooth area to work on. Now, there are going to be cases, and if I hold this up to the light, you can see the reflection along in here. When you have alcohol ink that pools into some areas and it gets a little bit thick, there are times when this can be a little bit difficult to write through with a Pitt pen. But there's nothing that says you can't do something like dot it with one of these Pebbio pens. Now, I've switched over to these, though I do use the Sharpies, I've switched over to the Pebbios because they're permanent when they're dry and I don't have to worry about the dots or whatever it is I've done with them moving. So this happens to be the 1.2 millimeter tip, and this is Precious Green, and I'm just picking up on the green that's already in this piece and using it to emphasize this kind of halo that forms where the ink gets thick and it provides this darker line. Sorry, can't talk here. And I can do the same thing around here. Now, if I want to create something as a flower, and you can see that I've picked out the center here, and there's another little bit of a ring that's formed out here. So I'm going to use the super fine tip, and if I kind of highlight that ring that's around here, and I fix it where it maybe doesn't flow into the exact shape of what I want, and by fixing that I mean I just make the line go where I want. Now I have a flower that's kind of built into an outer layer. And sometimes it's fun to just, sometimes the easiest stuff, the most effective stuff, is layers of simple elements. So this looks really cool when you start to put all these lines in. But let's say, for example, I get around this entire circumference of this flower, and then I say, all right, well, what else do I want to do? So if I add another layer that is these little open circles, that provides another layer of interest. And then I say, well, okay, so I have this whole perimeter out here. What can I do with it? Well, maybe it's as simple as just stacking a bajillion little dots on top of themselves that, while one dot doesn't do much on its own, but when you start to combine them, this becomes sort of the power of many as opposed to a single. When you start to combine them like this, now you can create an edge that's not real definite because it's not a hard line like this, but it creates interest around this area, and suddenly what looked a little bit bland in the beginning becomes so much more interesting because you've taken all these various elements and you've pulled them together through use of dots and lines and circles to create something really interesting. If you want to put actual flower petals, you can do that. You can make this kind of look like a petal. And here I took, this is the 1.2 millimeter, the deco marker in the white, and I just went around the edge here. Now, sometimes it's not real dark as much as white can be dark. It's not super opaque, I guess, at this point, just because it's a light color on a light area. So what you can do is come back and just dot over everything again, and that helps to really deepen that and make it even more opaque, and it makes them stand out a little bit more. Sometimes it's lines of circles that grow and change pattern according to how much area you have available to work in and what it does. So for example, on this white halo here, and remember we talked about the fact that this halo happens when there's not a lot of color on here because it allows the ink to push the paint out and then it forms this pretty cool halo. Now it's as simple as doing stuff like this, taking advantage of the amount of space that I have and just following the shape all the way around this blob until suddenly it becomes transformed into a thing, whatever it ends up being, even if it's just a plain old doodle. But it becomes far more interesting when you start to add these various layers and these elements. They all combine to create a really interesting whole. Same thing here. Now, this one was done with the Halo Pink Gold paint as my wet surface to drop the alcohol ink into. And interestingly enough, some of the mica, and it's a little less obvious. Where's the white one? It's a little less obvious on this because the color is so light. But you can see where some of the mica that makes up the metallic part of the paint actually flows back into the ink itself. You can see that there's, well, if I hold this to the light, maybe you can see it. But there's glimmer in here that absolutely comes from the mica that got trapped in there. So, you know, you have all of these shapes, and maybe you're not doing dots. Maybe you're doing lines, or you've got other shapes in here. You can still circle around them, and you can dot them, and you can put all kinds of things on them. You can reuse these kinds of elements in something that's not a circle or a flower shape. So alcohol ink on a wet surface, not blending with acrylic paint, but certainly reacting in a very magical way to it.